by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. Eight to they fool. Run through the night, playing with your life. Going against the pack.
All right, folks, we are back with another edition of the Red Mike Podcast. I'm your host, Evan, here with Will. I can actually see Will now. You folks can't see him right now, but I can see Will, and it is glorious, as you can imagine. Will, how are you doing?
I feel like my privacy has been violated due to this new format that required me to have a camera on to start. Did not appreciate that. Felt ambushed. No, I'm good, man. We're just in the middle of a storm here. I had to delay the start of this podcast because my dog had been holding it for quite some time, and we finally had a break.
Your dog is the most adorable thing I've ever seen.
You say that, but when I walk downstairs to get a water, she does this thing where she acts like she's about to bite your face, and then she stops the second she makes contact and, like, open mouth kisses you. It's disturbing, but she has, like, an anvil of a head, so when she does it, you, like, end up getting pretty bruised, and right as I walk down, Wahida got a face full of it, so it was I don't know if you heard me when I was like, oh my god, are you okay? So there was a Charlie victim tonight.
That's amazing. Well, still adorable. I wanted to get into, I don't want to rehash this because, well, I mean, I guess we will, but Chance and I already spent about an hour going over this, the whole baseball fiasco, right? I want to go through it from a different angle. But first, you and I hadn't really talked about it. What's your take on the whole thing, on how it went down, and just how are you feeling 6 days later?
I mean, I'm still pretty ticked off about it. I still don't understand why they couldn't have just delayed for a few days and let this thing work itself out. What frustrated me was that they didn't just go and test everybody that was left in the tournament at that point. Because I bet if they did that, there would be a lot of positives. And then they could have just had a fair pause, and then, you know, we could have had our shot. Now I'm just, you know, sitting here today after Mississippi State won and keep thinking, man, I wish they could get some kind of exhibition game set up with them as a, you know, obviously we'll recognize you guys are the champs, but don't you want to have beat the best team in the tournament? And they could do it to fundraise. I think it would be great for both teams to try to get extra money. I don't know anything about Mississippi State's baseball situation, but I know ours sure could have used that opportunity to raise up a bunch of money. And as far as I know, we didn't. Maybe it was done behind scenes, but I don't know. It was just, you wake up that morning and I'm like, all right, here we go, man. We're at least going to get an opportunity for greatness again. And to see that, you know, at 2 a.m, we had been, you know, not even, there's no need to rehash it, right? For most fans know what happened, but I could tell you, like, walking on the golf course the next day and randomly getting paired with two other state fans, it was definitely disgust. And we got it out on the first hole, and then we never brought it up again. So I think a lot of NC State fans are probably going to do that. They're just going to have to bury it. It's just a lost opportunity. It'll never come back again.
Yeah, to me, and that's the – and you touched on the reaction is where I'm at now, or lack of thereof. I just wrote 1,500 words scathing about – the lack of reaction, leadership vacuum. I mean, to me, you know, having thought about it for a little bit, the NCAA was not going to put any risk in them not having a World Series final. I didn't really think about it at first, but if there was any chance that they would have to disqualify us, they were going to find any way possible to make sure that they weren't in that position, and that meant sacrificing us. And I get it from a business standpoint. I mean, it kind of blows the integrity of the championship and all that. My biggest beef right now is with the administration on our side, both athletics office and the Wolfpack Club, just completely whiffing on the moment where you had 3-4 days where you're in the national spotlight and everybody is looking at you and everybody is talking about you, politicians and influencers and analysts and sports talking heads, and everybody is talking about it and they're supporting you, and we did nothing to capitalize on it. Boo put out two very empty statements, and then they did an awful Zoom call, like not even a real press conference. And it's just so, it's so disappointing that that was our reaction, when if you had been proactive, if you had put out a GoFundMe page or something, like sold some t-shirts with proceeds going to the baseball team, you would have put a big chunk of money in your pocket to support this team and to build the facility that people are looking for, and you know, all that stuff. You would have gone a long way in advancing that project. Instead, you come out a couple days later, yeah, we're gonna, you know, have something done by 2022 is what Boo said about the, you know, facility upgrades, which they've been saying for damn near 10 years now. Yeah. So I'll believe it when it happens. And it's just an unprecedented moment. You're trending on almost every social media platform and they don't take advantage of it for whatever reason. And to me, that comes top down. That comes from Boo, who oversees it all, right? Even if he is a passive in the guy in the background kind of guy, you need somebody to say, hey, we've got an opportunity here. You need to do something for the greater good. Even if it is outside your comfort zone, it is not your management style. And so to me, I'm super frustrated with how they reacted or didn't react in kind of taking control of this. And now they just sat back, and now we're all, instead of being rallied behind Boo and the rest of the administration, now everybody's taking aim at him, right? We've turned on him. And that's, that's his fault, man.
You know, there's probably nothing he could have done. I don't know. I kind of thought it was interesting. You know, they did that Zoom call. I think it was Gravely and Randy Woodson and him. And, you know, I don't know. Maybe Randy said, don't try to raise money off of this. Like, I don't know. It's very confusing in the moment. I mean, all they had to do was just come out and just be like, you know, it feels like a double standard is being placed on this World Series where home attendance is being bragged about, but players are being punished for testing positive, vaccinated players. And the fact that it just, I mean, I guess I just would have been like, you know, I think we should halt the World Series until we test everybody. If there's vaccinated players that are testing positive for this, like, you know, I guess one thing that is annoying is like, I haven't heard anything about the players. Like, are they, I assume they're doing okay, you know, health wise. In that, you know, they haven't been negatively impacted just from having the Delta variant, according to Randy, that's what it was.
Questionable.
I mean, my okay, so first off, I guess I'm, so the entire Mississippi State team is vaccinated, I assume.
I highly doubt that, knowing the demographic.
That's what I'm saying. It's like, so I mean, it's just utterly effed that, you know, only the NC State team has COVID and multiple vaccinated players. Like, it's just mind-blowing to me. Statistically, it doesn't seem to make any sense. So therefore, I would expect other people must have been sick. Oh, well, they're outdoors and they weren't in contact with them. Okay, well, if that's the thing, then they should be able to play.
Right?
Like, the argument can't be, oh, well, the other team couldn't have got it because they're not spending enough time with these people. But then the argument is, well, we can't let these guys play because they could spend enough time with each other. That's not how it works, right? So I think the timing of it is frustrating. It's a point in the pandemic where people are, I mean, I just get the general sense that no one really cares anymore. And, you know, were the vaccinated players for Vandy worried they were going to catch it? I doubt it.
Yeah.
You know, there's no reason that game couldn't have gone on. So I think there were a lot of paths that the administration could have either openly spoken out or leaked something to the press. you know, there were ways to probably manage that in a manner that didn't look, make us look like we were just taking it. And those statements from Boo and the PR firm style stuff, it's not what people want in the moment. I think I would have been much more happy if he had just tweeted out WTF and
yeah,
you know what I mean? Just something that connects, you know. I mean, it's just a perplexing manner to handle it. And I don't know, it just seemed like Randy Woodson was more passionate about the baseball team than Boo was on that Zoom. But again, that's his personality, whatever. You know, like in the years to come, I'm sure I won't care if football does something or basketball does something. You know, I see the investment he's done for football. So, yeah, I'm kind of with the rest of the people that are like, okay, you keep talking about plans. Why haven't you done anything for the baseball team?
Right.
I guess I feel like an idiot because I didn't realize how close we were to the finals. I, for some reason, thought that there was one more mini round robin or something to go through.
Nope.
So, I was sitting here, I was like, okay, I get that we're all mad, but, like, come on. Like, there's no guarantee we were going all the way. Okay. So, that's frustrating. And then you add in, like, the just the kick in the nuts where we don't even have a team or a player on the All-World Series team. You know?
Unbelievable.
Like, that's the one thing that they could have done as a kind of, okay, yeah, we screwed up. They could have put it even in asterisk. You know, we could have had the all-COVID team. I mean, I would have actually taken that if they had a little bit of jest. But, you know, I just think the whole thing was really hypocritical from the NCAA. And to keep slapping out these attendance numbers where no one is masked and no one's tested and they're constantly interacting with players after and before games. Like, you know, I think it's going to chap the NC State fans for a really long time. I, you know, it's like Boo's gonna boo. Just your job is just to get us money. That's all your job is. So go get us money. Hire the right coaches. But Jesus, man, it would have been such an easy, you know, I've just never, it's, you know what it reminds me of? I was playing this golf tournament, and we had this little thing where we could throw a ball as one of the things. And we were, like, 6 feet from the hole, and my dad was like, why don't you just lean over and toss it in? And I tried to do that, and my back felt really weird, and I threw the ball, and I missed. I said, okay, guys, clearly my back was wrong. And so I picked up the ball and did it again and missed the exact same way. And that's what I feel like Boo just did with those two statements. You know, and cost us a birdie as a fan base. God, just disappointing. That's all.
Yeah, you know, for me, the question, like, so Boo wasn't there when all this went down in Omaha. He was in Omaha earlier in the week, and then I think personal reasons had forced him to leave, which, whatever. My question is, then who was there fighting for us? And I got a feeling the answer is nobody.
I think it sounds like it was Avent.
Yeah, say Elliot was left on an island, and there's no reason they couldn't have that doubleheader. I mean, pretend it rained. Pretend, you know, it could have been anything. And, you know, just delay it. Or why are you taking the guys across town to a new testing site and then you're not delaying the game for them to get back? Or this Delta variant, air quotes, Delta variant, that is highly contagious that nobody else tested positive for, right? And, you know, the guys that had COVID or the guys that were vaccinated that tested positive had COVID previously were still inside that window that they were going to test positive. There's always a chance. Like, all these things, just who was there, like, saying these things to somebody? Like, this doesn't make any sense. And that's, you know, that part frustrates me. And then the reaction afterwards of not capitalizing on it. Now, you know, Boo's job is to get us money. Who the hell is it wants to give them money? Like, I got hit up in, I was tweeting today about it. Somebody had said something about we should put bleachers in the outfield in Doak. And I said, yeah, it would have been nice. You know, our post-booting campaign could have paid for that. And then like 30 minutes later, I get hit up on Twitter by somebody at the Wolfpack Club. Oh, you know, I'm getting names for donations. How much do you want to pledge? In my Twitter DMs, and I wrote a short but maybe not as polite reply as I should have, but I essentially said what we were talking about is, you guys have been talking about this for years. Show me some plans. Put it out in public. You know, convince me that I should be giving my money to you, that you guys are not inept. Because everything that I've seen right now has just been a big what the fuck. And it really bugs me. The whole reaction from everything about the sports marketing side, the money raising side, it was all terrible. And to me, we have to start getting better at that. If we want to win at anything, 422 championship tournament appearances, 2 national titles. That's what NC State has. 2 national titles, 422 chances. If you want to start getting better, if you want to win something, we've got to get better. We've got to like start acting like it. And that is super frustrating to me.
Yeah, I mean, well, first off, I was going to say, I thought when you first sent me the picture of that message that it was going to be you just raking this person over the coals for not saying you. They said, Y-U-H? Like, are you going to give some money? And I was like, oh my God.
I had to double check that it wasn't a scam. If they weren't followed by the Wolfpack Club, I wouldn't have known.
Yeah, I mean, I would say this, right? Like, a lot of those postseason appearances weren't on championship contending squads.
Sure,
right?
Sure.
So that's what makes things like this hurt, the women's basketball team hurt. You know, it's when you have a legitimate shot for an NCAA title and for things to get kind of taken away from you really, really sucks. You know, it's, my bigger question is like, okay, so is everyone on the football team going to get vaccinated now? Because we can't risk this BS in the fall. I mean, if you get vaccinated, the fully vaccinated, and then no one has to test, then everyone better get vaccinated. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm sorry if you have personal opinions about it. Like, whatever. Just take the freaking vaccine. I'm not hearing anything in the news about anything going wrong. So I hope the guys see that. I remember seeing Thayer Thomas, you know, just talking about how he was tweeting about how, you know, the vaccinated guys had it and they were still getting penalized. And I was like, well, God, I hope this doesn't have like the negative consequences there where people are like, well, so yeah, what's the point of getting vaccinated if you guys are going to still test me and hold it against me? So I hope we avoid that.
I mean, I hope we're done testing in the fall. Like, why are you testing football players at this point?
I mean, it's like, haven't these guys... I mean, if anyone... Those guys are, like, constantly in contact with each other, and I don't care if it's in for, like, 3 or 4 second bursts. Like, those guys are breathing all over each other in that sport.
Yeah.
I'm surprised there wasn't more widespread issues. It's probably because they were the first teams back during the initial wave, and I'm sure a lot of teams got hit pretty hard. But, you know, who knows? Now you got all these freshmen coming in that haven't been exposed to the college virus, so who knows? You know, I don't know. I'm kind of with you. Like, the thing that's annoying is, you know, what are the plans for the baseball stadium? Show me, like, the tiered approach. Show me... I saw Rob McLam was doing a really good job about tweeting about it, where it's like, can you at least put like Pac 13? Can you at least put any kind of slogans or anything you're going to do on the outfield wall so it's constantly seen and broadcasted instead of put on like the top of the dugouts? Like don't do us lazy. Like, we just spent so much money renovating Reynolds Coliseum, and I know it means a lot more to people probably than the baseball team stadium does to Doak, but, you know, is it really that hard to build a decent ballpark? I mean, all these little minor league teams have, you know, great ballparks, and they're not, I mean, they're usually not full. So, right. make it, make it, just figure out a way to fix this, man. That's how Boo can make this up, is get a big pile of money and go fix baseball. But it's going to be funny, because then that's going to happen, and then NC State's going to have like a 8-win season in the fall, and people are going to be like, why are you investing money in baseball instead of hiring the people we need to get over the hump in football? You know, so I get that we can be fickle, but I don't know, man. I don't even want to talk about it anymore. It's making me so mad.
I know. The last thing is, I didn't even realize until I think Jake Armstrong, former NC State player, mentioned it, that we don't have anything like out there representing the last time we made it to the College World Series, the 2013 team. And then I saw a picture of Doak, and there's literally nothing in the outfield, and you're like, Jesus. Like, come on, man. Again, it's just the little things that we don't do, and it's terrible. It's just unbelievably frustrating.
I mean, Evan, that's on the baseball team. They got to go out there and paint that themselves. Come on, show some pride right in your home field. Like
Banksy that shit.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, listener question. What do you think of Boo at this point? What has he accomplished? Have we been too harsh? We're truly in the midst of another AD nightmare.
We're not even close to AD nightmare. We're nowhere near Fowler.
Like, I don't think so.
You know, I mean, here's what he's done. He's gotten a lot of money for Doran's staff and things behind the scenes. You know, so I you've seen, like, the proper investment. Supposedly he's schmoozing the big donors. I don't think he was ever going to be Debbie Yao. I am still a little miffed at how relatively invisible he is, and his lack of engagement with the normal folks. Maybe that'll change now with like the NIL laws going into effect, and the little plebes like us can start basically giving money to players. maybe that'll right size how they approach us. Because I do think that's going to be one of the benefits of this. I'm sure we'll talk about that later, but you know, he hasn't cratered. He just missed. I don't think he understands that he missed a critical moment. He certainly doesn't seem to have tried to overcorrect and try to regain our attention. So maybe he just thinks it wasn't going to be worth it. Maybe there were tensions inside of the university about, you know... I'm sure there's a lot of people in the university who are like, these assholes couldn't get vaccinated. They just couldn't get vaccinated and avoid this. So why, you know, so I'm sure there's that publicity, not publicity, the public opinion, right, where they're probably navigating internally. Maybe that's why they were far more careful in how they approached this. But you know, all we know about Boo is he gets money to the coaches, he gets it from the donors, and he does not have an outward passionate appearance whatsoever. And maybe that's all you really need from an athletic director, but I think a lot of people miss that spirit and passion that Debbie represented. And, you know, at the same time, like, what exactly did she get, right? We don't have any national championships. So, I mean, right? I mean, Westmore has done it all under him, right?
Yeah, but I give that credit to Debbie. I
think I'm going to give the credit to Debbie. I'm just saying, like, if I want to be a contrarian for a second, like, I think a lot of athletic directors probably don't have incredible, massive accomplishments to point to unless they've done something with a stadium or... you know, hired some incredible coach, and then, you know, they'd get recognized. And frankly, I mean, Boo hasn't really been here long enough to really garner major praise. He's just managed to crap one gold mine of a situation, I guess, is how I put it.
I don't think we're in nightmare territory. I think... you know, Boo had done some good things with, like you said, with Dave's staff and getting the money there. I think you alienate the little guys, and that becomes a problem. Boo wants to focus on the big money, which we've talked about, but I in the end, you need everybody to contribute, well, especially when you're in NC State and you need all the resources you can get. You need $10 here, $100 there. Like, you should be able to get that from people. Right? There's probably, you know, the largest state school in North Carolina, and I imagine that 90% of the fans don't donate.
Yeah.
And you don't make it easy for them to do so. You don't give them any incentive to do so. And then when you have an opportunity to do that, to rally the troops, to get the people behind you, you don't do it, right? You don't take a hold of it. Like somebody said in the chat, that all Boo had to come out and say is, hey, we're going to fight for our guys. And everybody would have been behind him. That's it. One simple line. Everybody would have been behind him. And then, you know, buy yourself some time to move forward, right? And he didn't do that. And I think that's – I don't know if this is a learning moment for him. I don't know if he's capable of doing that. At some point, to me, even if it's not his management style to be out front and be with the masses, you need to recognize at some point where being different is needed, or going outside of your comfort zone, or what you do is the right course of action. And I think he completely missed that. I don't think it makes him a bad AD. I think he's just got a lot of ground to make up now, because he's kind of, like you and I were texting, I would love to see the reaction at the first Wolfpack caravan.
Oh my God.
Like, what is going to happen? You know, good luck, Boo. That's what I'll say. Good luck to you.
I mean, if he's smart, the first thing he'll do is come out and say, hey, I know I fucked up by not being more aggressive publicly for the fan base, but you got to understand our hands were tied. ABC. I mean, he could make his excuses there, and people are going to back off. But
right,
you know, got to
say
it.
Yeah, it's
just say like, hey, man, we are worried about kicking up this hornet's nest with basketball. Hey, we were worried that whatever. There's some other situation you guys aren't aware of that we're trying to hold us out, or who knows, right? Like, I mean, he could have said anything, or he could have been like, man, we were boned no matter what. We weren't going to have enough people to play once the vaccinated guys tested positive. You know, and what, you know, we just didn't think it was going to do us any good to piss on the NCAA right then. There's ways he can say it. It's just, I don't know if he will. Because, you know, like you said, maybe he doesn't really care. I mean, I was hoping I could find it, but apparently I have to upgrade my Slack experience in order to look for it. But I had left, like, a giant message when Chance was talking with Fred that one time. And, just about my thoughts on how they could, you know, incentivize donors who are more interested in having kind of the boutique experience than necessarily getting points for priority on season tickets or parking or whatever. And I think it would be really smart of them to start figuring out ways to let fans connect with the players and the coaches, and then figuring out a way for that money to then filter in to the players through the NIL stuff. Because I don't care. I'm not going to get season tickets. It doesn't make any sense for me financially and from a time commitment to invest that much money when I would much rather just give a smaller sum that's really targeted towards helping the players. You know, and I hope they can grasp onto that, because they're... You know, I think I saw someone posted on Twitter. There, it was like a Clemson thread, and they were like, "Well, if we can just pay the players through NIL, like, why am I in IPTE? Like,
right?
Don't I want my money just to go to the players? Like, who cares?" And I wonder if you're going to see like a lot of departments all of a sudden have some shortfalls in their fundraising. I know I'm skipping ahead here, but. Anyways, yeah, so,
well,
great job, Boo.
Yeah. Before we get into NIL, NIL is going to just mention that I'm excited. We have a new sponsor coming up. He's got a project going on that I'm happy to help contribute. He's a big State fan, and it's actually a product that I absolutely love. So he's agreed to sponsor the show, so we'll have that coming in the near future. I think... it'll connect with the audience. I think it's probably much needed right now for most people. But moving into the
is NIL, that a shake weight?
Yeah, a shake weight. Yeah, I'm actually stealing Runa Cooper from IPS. No.
Do you want to move out of North Carolina now that your AD has let you down?
Moving into the NIL. NIL went into effect today. And my only thought is that this is going to be a hot mess. There's already rumors of a school down the road promising recruits money or amounts of money via NIL deals. Like, already happening. And I know it's probably already happened previously, but it's out there now. And
yeah.
And this ties into the administration part where I was ranting on earlier. Are they ready for this? Because I also tweeted this out earlier this morning when this was going on. Has anybody at NC State reached out to small businesses and people who want to connect with athletes? Have they started creating that directory or that marketplace to connect A with B? I don't think so. I'm a small business owner. I have quite a few small businesses. Nobody has reached out to me. I'm an alumni. I'm a donor. I have this podcast, right? If anybody's going to get reached out to, it's probably going to be me. And they have it. Are they doing this, right? Is the administration on top of this? These are questions I want to know because I think this is going to have a dramatic impact in the success of any of our programs.
Well, you were very mean to the AD just now. So they probably listened to our podcast and said, these guys are really mean to Boo.
Yeah, F these guys.
They heard your, what was it on Twitter that you did? The live, like, chance thing where he was after the baseball.
Oh, Spaces, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. They're probably one of the 70 people that rolled in for that and said, oh my God.
It was, I don't know, man. I have all these questions because are we prepared? I think it's the new way, right? It's coming. And from an NC State angle, from a program angle.
Yeah.
How are the teams going to get involved? Are we going to have departments that are going to help this? Or are they going to facilitate these transactions? Or are they just going to say, hey, you're out on your own, but maybe we'll give you some education?
Like, yeah.
I'm curious what's going to go on there. If I'm NC State, I've already put together a list of businesses and people who would be interested in supporting my athletes. And I'm going to wave that around to every damn recruit. Look at this. There's 5,000 businesses here in Research Triangle that were, you know, looking to connect with people or looking to, you know, do some partnerships.
See, that's the thing. Well, first off, I think that everything I've read or seen is that, you know, they've got some outside firms that are assisting.
Yeah.
You know, they've linked up with, I think it's supposed to be influencer. I don't know. The way the stupid acronym is for this company. If there's one thing this world needs less of, it's startup shorthanding names. For their company names, I hate it. So I think they're going to have to, right? Because what's going to happen is the kids are going to have to start, if they make money over a certain threshold, they're going to have to start paying taxes on it. You know, they're probably going to have to get hooked up with lawyers if they're doing any of their, like, specific brand type things or making any kind of, you know, C-corps, S-corps, LLCs, whatever, to manage their situation. And they're going to need that help. Unless these kids have a lot of experience from social media influencer type stuff that where they would have gone through this already, I expect it's going to be like the first time for a lot of these kids. So that's the first part. The second part is I don't know how much, like, we could say there's 5,000 businesses in this area. I guarantee you 99% of them don't give a crap about college athletes. They are not going to significant companies are probably not going to get the draw that they would need from a small regional tiny boost from a fan base like that. I think it's going to be more targeted to people that are connected to the school or things that really make sense for integrating with the players. And it's going to be players that already have probably a large enough social media following where it would make sense that they might have some clout that could help you out. So I feel like it's going to be more of these like random offshoot product type companies, or like what Aaron McLaughlin was like, you can play with me on Yoke or whatever, where we play video games together and you pay to play with me. Okay. Like, I can see stuff like that. Like, I don't see, like, you know, like, Apple or Google really reaching out into this space. If they do, it's going to be for very specific athletes, I would think.
Right, yeah. I'm not talking about them. I'm talking about people, state alumni who have businesses.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
There's a ton, and there's a lot that would, you know, they're gonna pay $20 or $50 for some tweets and some Instagram posts or whatever, because you know, if they have you know, decent business with the margin, that stuff makes sense. If you can reach a few thousand people here, a few thousand people there, then yeah, they absolutely will.
I mean, as a fan today, I said I was willing to give $1,000 to silly athletic challenges to do with athletes. So I know that the money and the passion is there. But it's like, people are just like, oh, teams are going to set aside $300,000 contracts for to pull. I was like, okay, no, they're not. Like, because how many of these people could you – look, there's only 85 roster spots, and there's only 11 people who get to start at a given time during the game. I don't think you're going to have a $3.5 million per side of the ball roster for NIL endorsements. If you are, you are at a very select few programs. I mean, if I was Boo – and I would go to my booster network, right? And I would say, listen, guys, it's going to be a wild, wild west for a year or two. So instead of investing in a specific upgrade or campaign we're doing, we're going to have you invest in the athletes themselves. And we know it's going to be hardly any return on actual investment, but guess what? So is giving money to any sports program.
Yeah,
because you get no ROI.
It won't go like that.
You get no ROI.
It will never go like that.
10%. I know they won't.
10% of the athletes are going to make 90% of the money. Like, I think that's. I think you're for sure right there.
Yeah.
I think the others could get creative in how they do it, and they might not make enough money, but they might make some beer money, some stuff like that. Like you said, we were coming up with ridiculous challenges today, like that people are like, oh yeah, I would do that. I would go and have a 3-point shootout with Reyna Perez, or I would, you know, pay Sam Highfield for 50 pitches. Like,
it wouldn't be much of a shootout. Can we tie a hand behind their back? Like, if
like just stuff like that, you know, it's not camps and it's not just social media. But just engagements, I think there's going to be some opportunities like that for folks. You know, how cool would it be? You know, one of my questions is what can the university do? And I used this earlier, is can we have a flag football game and have Bam Knight like officiating our flag football game in the indoor practice facility? Like, will they let him coordinate that? You know, that's some interesting questions. I think that would be fun.
Yeah. Well, like, remember, this would go against the code of what that event was about, but, like, Lift for Life, right? Like,
right.
Let us come to there and let us actually pay the athlete, like, just be like, hey, I'm going to sponsor $100 a lift here, whatever, right?
Yeah.
The winning team in the tug of war gets, you know, this pool of money or whatever. Like, I mean, that's not how, you know, you'd hope they would then split it up, but whatever. I mean, I guarantee you, the people that are going to win the most in NIL... I hope this doesn't come across as sexist, but it's going to be female athletes, I guarantee, are going to come out ahead of 99% of the football players.
Oh, absolutely.
If 10% are really making any kind of endorsement, like Derek King got $20,000 two $10,000 signing bonuses and whatever else he's getting paid for, like, heavy hauling company, and I can't remember what the other was.
Yeah.
You know, so you're going to see stuff like that, but I guarantee you some of these female athletes are going to make a huge amount of money just from influencer posts on social media. Right. Like, and I hate to say it like that, but like that's just the truth. And I hope it happens, because I think the most funny, like, ironic twist of this whole thing, you know, everyone's like, oh, what about Title IX? How is Title IX going to handle this? I guarantee you those, a lot of those ladies are going to come out way ahead of, like, an offensive lineman. Like, I was going to say a joke this morning. I mean, so all the NC State athletes had, you know, their, you know, if you want to think, you know, because of the NIL, if you want to reach out to me, message me, blah, blah, blah. And so it was like, you know, you saw Devin Leary and you saw Bam Knight, and then it was, one of the offensive linemen, I can't remember who it was, and it wasn't Icky, and I was just like, I'm curious to see how many this guy gets.
Yeah.
And I'm sure it's like that for everywhere, right? Because, you know, it's just...
The market's going to adjust, right?
Yeah. Because it's going to go top-heavy right away towards quarterbacks, wide receivers probably, maybe some running backs, you know, and then it's going to settle. Because, again, I think a lot of people are going to be like, why do I want to give this money? Unless you're a big fan and you're just like, want to make sure so-and-so can go out on the town. But I think it would be smarter, instead of signing like a $10,000 endorsement deal with De'Aaron King, like, don't you want his offensive line to want to protect him?
Right.
Maybe make it a $2,000 per person and make it the 5 starting linemen and De'Aaron King or something like that. But I'm sure it's going to get figured out. I mean, I just, this fear that a UNC or someone has hundreds of thousands of dollars that are going to be sitting there in a slush fund to dole out in NIL deals. Fine.
Yeah.
There's no rules right now. Like, yes, that's... do that. Break, push the limits while you can, and while you can point to and say, well, the North Carolina government didn't give us any rules, and you gave us the most bare-bone framework possible, so of course I'm going to go out here and promise the world while I can.
Right.
I hope we sign players because of it. I hope the coaching staff is like, hey, there's nothing better than everyone getting paid. You know, just don't be the Dabos.
Yeah. I think the part that concerns me with Carolina is that they are more organized than we are. And, you know, they've had
corrupt.
It's legal now, so it's not corruption. They've had the dentist programs and all those other programs where...
Oh, my God. I forgot about that.
Yeah. Like, they've got all this stuff already going on. They've already got it coordinated. They're doing these things. You know, that part, you know, kind of concerns me because I don't see our side doing that. And not saying that we can't, but they feel like a step ahead in that regards. I think it's going to level out. The market's going to be flooded with, you know, it's going to be interesting what it does to, like, the influencer market was very cornered by good-looking females on Instagram, right? And now it's a whole new world out there. So I wanted to, you know, the economics of supply and demand are going to bring that price way down for a lot of these things. So it's going to be interesting to see what kind of money's out there. I don't think it's going to be ridiculous money like people think. Now, I think the interesting aspect will be if you're a guy like, let's just use Bam Knight, for example, who,
oh my gosh,
is successful in NIL and making some money at State, and he's borderline, should I go pro or should I attempt to go to the draft? Does he stick around an extra year because he's getting money and it's less pressure on him to, you know, go pro? Or you have some of these other guys, like if you go back all the way to, you know, basketball, like Trevor Lacy, right? His thing was that I'm getting old and I'm getting too old for this. Like, if he's making money in college, does that change his mindset? I'm not sure, but I think it's going to be really interesting to see how that trend develops.
I think that would be great for the sports.
Yes.
I think anything that could lead to talent retention would be great. I just would be honestly shocked if, you know, if you're turning down Euro ball contracts, right? That's probably, I mean, that's minimum like 6 figures overseas typically for these guys with the amount of talent. So you'd really have to be getting a lot to justify that. So, I mean, we'll just really have to see. Like, I mean, the way I saw it, or the way I thought it could be used, first off, I mean, Bam Knight, I basically wrote a Nesquik commercial today.
That was amazing. That
no one from, I'm disappointed no one from Nesquik reached out to me or Bam. Bam, if they have, please just tie me in. I'm just here as a consultant. I'm not here for any percentages. just here to be a part of the team. But I mean, the way I see it is, it's, I think a lot of these guys will have the opportunity for a lot of like onesie twosie one off type things where it's like, hey, we got $150 and we'll give Peyton, Drake, and Isaiah $50 each to come on for a few minutes and just break down some plays. Yeah. On a pod or on a video. Like, and I hope that, I think the team would be really smart to just set up like a pool for stuff like that. And not, I can't remember what it was that Derek King and them like set up today where like that Ole Miss quarterback said he was like $10,000 for an appearance or whatever. And he didn't even have a photo up on the freaking interface. But like, I think it would be really smart for teams to set that up and say, hey, you know what? If you guys want to talk directly to the players, here's the flat fee, and it's going to get distributed to the whole group because the team puts these guys, and maybe only a few of them really are qualified to talk or feel comfortable talking. You know what I mean? Or I would have, like, a captain. I would have, like, Isaiah Moore or someone like that. But at the same time, like, you don't want distractions. So, you know, I think the good teams are going to find some way to balance it out. You know, like, just...
That's interesting.
Meet the Pack Day should be, I pay you for that autograph. Like, let me make those donations. Make a donation for being there to the broader programs. And then let me say, hey, all right, $10 for every autograph I want. Like, I know people don't like that. But at the same time, like, that's an easy way to make these guys all feel included. And, you know, it gives you a piece and access to the program. But at the same time, it's like, one of the things that Cover 3 kind of brought up today I thought was really interesting was what percentage of the actual college football and basketball fan base actually cares about NIL? And they were probably like, probably not many. It's not going to affect the way many people watch. They're going to go, oh, that's interesting. Oh, I'm curious if, you know, someone eventually will sign like a six-figure deal, right? It's just, it's bound to happen.
Yeah.
And it's going to be incredible to watch them when that person is either like, a complete bust or that money somehow,
or they transfer.
Yeah, or they transfer. And you know, that's the other thing I was gonna say earlier is like, good god, I was like, I hope the school has people assisting these guys with these contracts, because I could just see it where an NC State fan says, hey, I'm invested in you, and there's something in that fine print that says, well, if you transfer, I get my damages, my liquidated damages for you leaving. So it's going to get murky for a little bit, but all these people acting like, oh, this is going to ruin sports and blah, blah, blah. It's like, no, Joe Blow should have been able to go walk out, and if someone wants to give him a $50 handshake for, you know, standing up with a thumbs up in front of a car, he should have been allowed to do that all along. You have the same ability for a scholarship student to go get paid. So I don't think this is going to change anything. I think we probably got a question about how quarterbacks or someone are treated. Is that the next one?
Yeah, so the question is, are QBs, we all know the QB stars get treated differently. Does the money impact the locker room? Will there be adjustment? My answer to that is no. They already know that the certain positions get all the love. I think it might force some people to try harder or to be more personable or to put themselves out there a little bit differently. I think that might come into play. I don't think it's going to affect the dynamic there because that dynamic's already in play.
Yeah. Has it ruined NFL locker rooms, really? Yeah. Has it ruined the baseball locker rooms? I'm sure that there are people who are like, I can't believe this guy's getting $50 million. What a douchebag. I'm so much better than him. Okay, we'll prove it. Go earn your contract. Go earn the money. To your point, it's like there is always going to be a natural dynamic in marketplaces where certain things are just going to be valued. Even though someone in an organization is really the reason anything is getting done, doesn't matter. If someone's the face always gets more. CEO always gets more, even though sometimes it's questionable how much impact they really have on the bottom line.
Yep.
So, you know, quarterbacks, wide receiver, you know, anyone that's an explosive playmaker or is a star athlete, like Bradley Chubb would have made a ton of money in the NIL era. Like, I actually can't think of a better person. Him and then maybe, like, Jay Sam just smack-talking. But Jay Sam wouldn't have got as much as Chubb. And, like,
Julius Hodge.
Do you think anyone on the team would be upset about that? Julius Hodge? Yeah, exactly. some people are naturals for this environment, and they should be rewarded, because honestly, it could be the last time that they could earn this kind of scratch just for this. I mean, all it takes is blowing your knee out at the wrong time or suffer. Well, who was it? Lattimore?
Yeah.
Right? Like, why couldn't that guy have profited for the first couple years at South Carolina? And then he just has this terrible career-ending injury. Maybe he had an insurance policy on himself, but other than that, like, he ain't running anywhere to make money. So, you know, the one thing I was hoping, maybe, I don't know what the rules are going to be, but, like, I think it would be great if the boosters or the fan base or whatever could basically just, you know, almost essentially create, like, a charity, like a hardship charity that says, hey, we're going to pull a bunch of money together and we're going to put together kind of like some packages to help the players who have families in worse off situations. Maybe it's making sure that they get a plane ticket up to the, you know, up to a game or something like that, or, you know, maybe a, just something. And yeah. I think there's ways that this could be really good.
I don't think we'll
and
get there.
I mean, who knows? Yeah. I don't know, man.
I think it's going
to
be
a to the point where you're like, we got millions of dollars, we got to spend, we got to spend.
It's going to be a shit show is what it's going to be for a little while, and then it's going to come together, and you know, somebody's going to try to list the control over it, whether it's the NCAA or the next entity or the schools. I don't think the schools are, because they got enough going on. I just, it's just going to level out. Like you said, I don't think the market is going to demand the rates for everything. I don't think it's going to change how the locker rooms are perceived. It's just going to be, it's going to be different, but at, you know, eventually we'll stop caring about it. Eventually you might see one off, this guy gets a deal, that guy gets a deal. I think the people who are going to care about it are going to be from the recruiting standpoint. You know, what's kind of shady stuff is happening there, but that's already happening, right? That stuff's already going down. So, now it's just a little bit, it's a pig with a different color lipstick on it.
I mean, hello, the FBI was trying to stop Adidas and Nike and all these other shoe companies from influencing recruits. You don't think that there's some guy named Brian out there that's running bags of Chick-fil-A full of money to somebody?
Right.
There's always going to be that in college football and basketball. You got to just take it with a grain of salt. It happens. Oh man, I was gonna make a point and now I've lost it. Oh man, it'll come back to me. God, Evan, you were making such good points. Thank you, thank you.
There's
thank
your
you.
Applause. I got a new soundboard, folks. This is fun. All right, moving on. NIL is gonna be interesting. We'll be talking about it for a while. I don't know what direction things are gonna go.
Oh, I remember what I was gonna say.
All right, you bring it back to me.
If NIL was here for the last 3 years. We have to admit, like, Trevor Lawrence would have had an incredible shampoo.
Oh, yeah, certainly.
Promotion, right?
Yeah, certainly.
Hundreds of thousands of dollars from, like, Pantene or somebody. And, like, is that bad for the game? No. Like, I mean, you should be allowed to invest in, like, generational talent, things like that. It's going to happen anyways. Trevor Lawrence is always going to have a shit ton of money.
Yeah.
Like, why does it matter if he gets it when he's at Clemson? We already know he did. But, anyways, moving on.
All right, real quick, give me your top three, four NC State athletes who would have profited if NIL was a thing.
I posted this on Twitter earlier. It would have been Chubb, Rivers, Wilson, and I was going back and forth between Mario and Holt. I feel like those guys would have capitalized, but Mario would have had so much attention with what he was doing that I think he would have been making a lot of money. And then you would have seen him driving around in these really... his truck says, like, Big Bad
Big
Wolf
Bad
or something
Wolf,
on it.
Big Bad Wolf.
Yeah. So I think those guys, right? I think Rivers just would have... You know, he's putting together the seasons. He's so talkative. I mean, he is who he is. Wilson, you know, maybe that's why... Maybe he would have made enough... That he would have been able to buy TOPE out of his contract.
Oh, that wouldn't
he could have stayed. Chubb is just the personality. I mean, he could have made so much money from like a moist towelette company when he would rip someone's towel away and then replace it with a sani wipe.
That's great. Yeah, I was going to go I still think Jules would have been the best. He would have made the most money. And I think you, like you said, I think somebody like Ace Koenig or mm-hmm. some of these other females probably would have crushed it. Yeah.
Oh, I guarantee it.
Yeah.
I mean, human nature, you can easily profit off of it. Everyone is drawn to those things. I think someone posted it, like, right away. There was, like, I don't know where they're from. I'm guessing they're, like, volleyball players or something. But someone said something. There was, like, I don't know, Cal State or someone.
The Twins.
They were, like,
yeah.
Yeah, who are these people? I don't even know them. But I have a good idea without even knowing them what
softball players out west with millions of TikTok or Instagram followers or whatever. I forgot what school they were from. Yeah, they're sisters, and they are insanely gorgeous. So.
Yeah,
they're gonna make a lot of money.
Like, yeah, I mean it's great that attractive people can start making money from being attractive, but you know it's a tough life that they live.
all right, moving on. We're done with NIL. We got some football things. A bunch of questions people asked us, and I want to get into. So I'm gonna play my transition sound.
Oh, I thought we were going into the holiday questions. Oh, whoa!
You like that? That was a strong, strong transition. Are you curious about O-line recruiting? How important do you think it is to solidify depth in this class? We've talked about this a lot in the pod chat over the last couple of weeks, and I'll give you my quick take, and you can let me know what you think. I think it's the hardest position to evaluate without them actually playing and not seeing them in person over the last year. And you don't, because you need, with offensive linemen, it's all projection. You're looking at, are they going to grow? Are they going to be able to, you know, fill out this body, et cetera, et cetera. And so I understand why they're having a hard time finding offensive linemen. And I got a feeling they're going to rely on the portal more this side around.
Yeah. It's, look, I don't have big requirements for the offensive line. I mean, we seem to be incredible at recruiting interior offensive linemen, and all I ask for is that you give me, like, just give me Tyler Jones style tackles. You know, he was 6'3". I think he had like an extremely long arm span, and that's why he was effective. And he was a great tackle for us. And that's where I'm kind of just sitting here like miffed, where it's like, okay, last year we missed out on, like, multiple prospects like Mugger Bill and others that would have been what we have needed. And then you had, like, three guys from the Band of Brothers era that didn't pan out either. And now there's this gaping hole where tackles are supposed to be. And you've got your elite NFL offensive guard playing tackle right now in Ike Ekwonu, and maybe that will continue to work out, but I sure as heck would have loved to have the guy that's going to be playing that as a professional playing offensive guard now and leveraging his capability and his mismatches out there. And I'm still sitting here wondering, going into the season, who's going to be the right tackle. And it just doesn't give me any warm and fuzzy feelings to know that, again, we're concluding June, and maybe the fall will be a surprise as far as offensive linemen, but it just seems like for some reason we're just missing in this department. I don't understand why. We should have enough opportunity and history to get these players, and we just seem to be just missing for some reason.
I think it's hard to evaluate.
I do think we'll go... I know it's hard to evaluate, but we're not getting the guys we want either. So, like, I mean, I got to be real. Like, we're swinging and missing on tackles for some reason. And, you know, I'm fine with this going the transfer method. I just, you know, I think you can – I think there will be plenty of off interior linemen in the portal. And the problem is going to be that really good tackles are going to be a premium. And – I, you know, just like I was saying with running back transfers.
All right,
you know,
you beat me to it, but I'm gonna jump to it. I'm gonna ask you.
Just
Bennett Galloway, right? He's the kid we're recruiting.
Boy, when he commits, I will be so happy.
He's extremely fast. He doesn't have a whole lot of offers. He's from South Carolina. But he came to camp and blew everybody away. And to me, I think he's a great he'd be a great addition and a great add to Michael Allen.
Yeah.
I think Will kind of got the short end of the stick here from a lot of folks on certain message boards because he felt the same way, and they were just like, go get somebody from the portal.
Yeah. I think we've got plenty of guys that will align to portal running back expectations. Where, and the way I calibrate that is, you know, if you're bringing someone in and you're like, okay, the guy's averaged like 4 yards a carry and gets like 600 yards, 400 to 600 yards a season, he's reliable, he's going to know pass protection, like, I can always get that person. That person's always available. That's not a unique back. That's not going to help you win more games. When Galloway came to camp, I don't have his numbers in front of me right now, but I want to say it was like a 4.45 40. His shuttle time was like sub 4. It was like 3 something. It was like a world class shuttle. And his broad jumpers or his standing, whatever, his vertical leap were extremely good. Enough where the coaches were like, holy crap, yeah, we need to give this person an offer. I don't care if he never even gains a yard for us. His upside with his numbers suggests that, if anything, his short area quickness is going to get him playmaking ability. And he looks, at least on video, and if his laser time or his time bears out from camp, which usually if you run like anything under 4.5 at a state camp, you're really fast with how our grass is, supposedly. So I'm sure they probably ran him actually
indoor. Mow that grass.
Come on. No, we're like the equivalent of Notre Dame back in the day when they had like, you know, like, yeah, the 8-inch high grass for California coming, where I've never understood the theory of, oh, we're going to slow down the people who are fast by making it harder for our slow people to tackle them. But you know, so my position on the board was, get explosive playmakers who have the opportunity to make you big plays, yes, in one or two touches, versus guys where you're like, okay, yeah, he's going to be reliable, but I have that already. You have Delbert Mims. You have Penix. You've got guys who could just, you could trot out there and achieve that. Jordan Houston's already proved he could do that.
Yeah.
So you could swing him over. So I didn't understand the insistence that getting that type of back would be helpful to NC State. The counterpoint, which I guess is where I really just rub people wrong, where I said, now if we're talking about people who have the same explosive playmaking characteristics that this Galloway kid seems to have, at least by his numbers, and they're producing at some level, I'm sorry, I just really have a hard time believing that NC State is at the top of that list unless they have a local connection or some reason that NC State should be favored that way. Oh, yeah. But what if Bam and Person do really well? Okay, but what if Bama, LSU, blah, 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 like any of the big dogs come hunting? I don't think NC State is pulling that kind of player. And I don't think that's offensive to the brand of NC State. I think it's a realistic approach. So I'd rather take a risk on someone who has been to your camp and you have seen them and you have vetted them because they come from a program where you just picked up another prospect a year prior.
Yeah.
Like, you should have a very good feel of who this kid is. He's going to be grateful to be here. And you may have found a surprise player. And he's not going to upset your stud that you're bringing in with him. He's going to be viewed as a complimentary back. Like, to me, it's just, why wouldn't you take that?
He's potential. He's got the measurables. Yeah. He's got the speed. And, again, you can use him as a development piece. If the, you know, if he needs a couple of years to develop, then by all means, that's what you want, right? You want somebody, yeah, that's going to be, you know, reliable back there. We don't have the 4.4 speed across the board. So if you can get a guy like that who has everything else going for him, why wouldn't you take him? Just because you want to maybe find somebody in the portal who may be good? You're not finding 4.4 running back in the portal that is, a sure thing to come to NC State. It's like, just, that's just not likely. It's, anyway. I almost forgot.
I was trying to pull up his numbers while we were talking. Sorry.
Right. He's fast. That's all
four,
you need to know.
Four, 4.45, 40, 3.96 pro shuttle. That's insane.
Yeah. Do you feel like momentum has come back from the 19 that we lost with Max's arrival?
I guess I'd have to go back and look. I mean, it's funny. I was talking with my buddy who's a really, you know, he's a big UNC football guy. He's been dead for the longest time. And we were talking. We were sitting in front of a fire talking. And I was like, listen, man, I got to be honest. I've watched your team enough. I don't understand what's going on with this hype. And he was like, well, the defense should be so much better. And that's the thing. I was like, yeah, but your offense could be just as worse. Like, yeah. it could offset. And I was like, you're going to throw the ball a lot. But I was like, I didn't see like some incredible defense last year. I see kind of what I've always seen from a UNC defense. And you know, so I don't know if really Mac has really changed anything over there. Like, it's just like with Butch Davis, man. I gotta see it like 2 or 3 years later after each class and see who's there, who isn't just a 24/7. You know, ranking kid versus an actual football player. You know, I'm trying to remember who it was. Was it Bryce Steele that was getting compared to Jordan Poole?
Yeah.
Maybe I'm thinking, yeah, that's who it was, I think. Or it might have been the other kid. There was another guy they took that was, I think he was playing like safety and, you know, but like Jordan Poole, I think had like 40 pounds on him and was putting up the exact same numbers. And, you know, it's unlikely, at least, you know, historically, that this other kid's going to necessarily grow into the... He didn't have the frame, per se. He didn't have the weight. Like, it was kind of like he's getting a lot of upside right now, and then they're not looking at the player right beside him who is much more college-ready.
I think you're
right?
Overanalyzing this question.
I probably am. So what I'm trying to say is I don't see any difference from UNC 5 years ago to 2 years ago
right.
to today.
I think,
you know, they're going to get a couple 5-star or 4-star guys, and they're going to have better rankings than us. And then, you know, the problem on the field, the problem has been we have been super injured.
What?
19,
all right,
we were super
hold
injured.
On. All right, I'm going to interrupt you. Is
I can't.
He's talking about recruiting, and
I'm going to
go with that it's not about Mac. I think our staff, we finally have a legit staff, and I think they did a good job in the pandemic identifying their guys and getting them early. I think that's why.
Where's my soundboard to boo you?
I don't know where you were going with what you were going with.
My point is that people are so focused on Mac. Thank you. Thank you. People are so focused on Mac, and they're forgetting that Mac came in at a time where NC State has literally could not have like had the worst possible luck. And I just don't see the difference. They just have a really good quarterback right now. And he'll be gone next year. And, you know,
we'll see.
It'll be the same story.
Yeah. You done?
Oh, man, people just bring up Grandpa, and I can't.
What player?
I do want to use his golf simulator, I will say.
What player do you... His office, man. His office is legit. Have you saw that picture? Oh. Holy crap, that was nice. What player do you predict will have a breakout year in the football this year? For us, not UNC.
In the football?
In the football. For us.
God, I feel like we do some derivative this often.
And
I'm trying to think of a different way to approach it. Probably like, I'm going to go defensive line, CJ Clark.
Oh, that's a good one.
That's someone that's going to be kind of unexpected. I mean, honestly, if Josh Harris is on the field as much as I think he might be, just kind of based on the tiny little vibe tidbits we're getting. You know, maybe he's going to be that guy. If I went on offense, I mean, I think Zavala is going to be... I mean, if his ability matches up to what he's doing so far just in the weight room with these guys and playing, you know, tug of war or whatever, I think those two linemen are going to be breakout candidates.
I was going to go with Shy Battle. I think he's going to have a big year.
He's trying to get some endorsements.
I know. I loved it. I loved it. If he's not too busy getting endorsements, I think he's going to big year. I think he's going to get some picks. I think he's going to make a name for himself. I'm going to take it a different angle, like you said. We answer this question a lot. And then offensive side, I don't know.
Oh my god.
What do you got?
I mean, it's got to be Ant Smith and Chris Scott. I mean, we're missing a brand opportunity right now.
No, I've already beat the Ant Smith drum. I'm a big Ant Smith fan. I was trying to think of somebody different. I don't know.
Did we get him? Did he like your tweet today?
Ant did not, but Tanner Engel did. Reyna Perez did. Devin Leary did. Sam Highfield did. I got everybody else. So I'm gonna guess Ant's not a big Twitter guy. So only reason I can explain that he did not buy into the racing Ant for dollars.
Yeah. It's even harder to find my boy Chris Scott Jr. on there. So
yeah,
I found Chris Scott Sr.
Tweet his dad.
I thought about tweeting to him, and I was like, you know, I'm gonna pump the brakes on day one.
I don't know if you and I have talked about this, but your breakout candidate, Titus Dorsey.
Who is this?
Redshirt senior. Redshirt of the season. I guess he's a COVID sophomore. He's an NC State wide receiver. But listen to his bio. I had mentioned this before. I was going through the roster and I saw this picture and I was like, who is this guy? He looks like he's 35.
What's his name? Titus what?
Titus Dorsey, number 25. 5'10" from Lewisburg, North Carolina. Played quarterback and free safety for the North Wake Saints homeschool football team under head coach John Dorsey. So he played for the homeschool football team. His dad was the coach.
Okay.
Team ranked number one in the nation for homeschool football. Did you know that was a thing?
It took me the second time reading that line to see that it's at homeschool. How does this even work?
I don't know. How do you find this guy? Like, who is he playing? It's like a neighborhood pickup game.
Hold on a second. He passed for 743 yards. He rushed for another 700 yards. And solo had 19 solo tackles. Oh my god, this guy looks like he's 88.
I'm telling you, this is crazy.
He also played baseball and had 54 stolen bases. So this guy's got some wheels.
He's got some wheels. Yeah. I'd never seen a bio like that.
He's a statistics major.
Mm-hmm. Homeschool football team. So there is a chance.
5'10", 176. I don't think he's gonna break out for us this year.
Titus,
he's a safety, right?
Wide receiver.
No, is he?
Well, redshirted the season at wide receiver 2019. Yeah.
Okay.
Let's go, Titus.
He's on the main roster page. He's listed as a safety this year, so maybe he is the he's the Tanner Engel backup for when I give Tanner $1,000 for knocking out Sam Howell. And we got to get Titus Dorsey in there to back him up.
That's wild, man. I'd go through the roster and like, I had no idea this guy existed. Yeah. Homeschool football.
What do you think homeschool football is like?
That's what I'm trying to figure out. Is this like neighborhood ball? Like, are they playing in the street, in the cul-de-sac?
I thought that there was something I had read that, like, I don't know if it's in all states, but like the homeschool kids could then go play after school sports with the high school.
Probably, but this guy played for the North Wake Saints homeschool football team with his dad as a coach.
We gotta go to a North Wake Saints game.
We have got to find out when the North Wake Saints play because I'm so curious.
I guarantee you could walk out there with your how old was your boys'
six.
Flag football team?
Six.
Yeah. Hey guys. I bet you guys could go out there and challenge them.
You want to play? You want to play? You can't keep up with this kid, I'll tell you that much. Ray, all right. I think that's all the sports-related things we have here.
Are there any other Mac questions?
Anybody want more? 15 more minutes of Will ranting on Mac Brown?
Oh, my gosh, Mac Brown. I'm so tired of it.
We get a bunch of random questions all the time, so I got them in here. This one I think is interesting and is right at my wheelhouse. Business pod question. If you were starting a business, how much of your own money would you be willing to invest? I have an idea in my head, put down quite a bit already, and I'm trying to figure out how much I should commit to purchasing up front. So I assume it's been a product and not like an app or something like that. What I would do is, and what I've started doing with ideas and projects that I put out there, start taking some kind of pre-sale or start building some kind of list of interest, because you don't want to go into it cold. And, you know, people will be willing to, you know, support a production run if you, you know, that's, you go through Kickstarter, right? That's the whole foundation of Kickstarter. You tell a good story and people will, all right, I'm in, you know, I'll support this project. And you can do that without, obviously, a Kickstarter. And you can build that list and you can build some momentum so that you don't have to outlay a whole bunch of cash and take that risk. Because I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't do that without some sort of, you know, customer guarantee up front, or without creating some sort of customer relationship and start building that out before you, you know, buy 100 widgets or whatever you're, you know, whatever you may be selling. That's how I would approach it. All right, Phil. All right. Life pod question.
Oh my God, this question. I'm going to have to look up a list.
Your three favorite holidays.
Three favorite holidays.
While you're looking really up the list of holidays, I'm going to say my list of holidays has changed as I've gotten older. Certain things, I'm like, yeah, that was awesome. That was a good time. Now I'm like, eh, this is stupid. I don't really care about this. You know, particularly Halloween. Like, it was awesome when you're in college or when you're really little. And then you get to that point where either like pre-kids or whatever, and it's just like, Halloween, it's okay. And then it starts to become fun again when you have kids and you can walk your kids around and they have fun. But it kind of, you know, my view is going to change dramatically over time. But what are your three holidays?
Well, I agree with you that, well, first off, Halloween isn't even a holiday.
Right.
I mean, it's a day we go out and dress up and get stuff, but we don't get a day off. What are my favorite holidays? Any holiday that gets me time off of work is always a favorite. Well, I mean, in this household, Eid is now important, though I don't get time off for that. I'm a big fan of Labor Day, not going to lie. Well-timed, always well-timed. President's Day, can't complain about its timing either.
Just, no forced obligations. You don't have to go to a party or host a
exactly.
cookout.
That's the kind of holiday I like. Yeah. Like, because I was just thinking about with July 4th, right? It's like, this morning I got a text, and it's like, I'm not going to be able to say no, and I'm going to have to go down somewhere for the day, and it's going to be a good time, but it's like, yeah, I have this obligation that I got to go out there. So I prefer any holiday that's just truly a people are getting time off. I guess we get to take as a floating holiday, Election Day at my company. So I'm a big fan of that. Yeah, I'd say that. I mean, I'm sure people are going to be like, oh, Evan and Will don't like Christmas.
But, I was going to say Christmas.
Yeah, I mean, but Christmas is a given. Like, I don't know who... No one hates Christmas, except, well, hold on. No, we're not going that direction on this podcast. So, yeah, I'm a fan of the bank holidays.
The bank holidays. Interesting. What about steak?
That's what we called it. My dad ran a bank growing up, so anything that was a bank holiday, I was like, all right, cool, we're off.
What about steak and blowjob day? That's a holiday.
What?
Steak and blowjob day.
Oh. This is a family-friendly podcast, Evan.
No, but nobody's kids are listening this far into the podcast.
This is how we make money. March 14th. People are like, why? How are they? We've got all these advertisements for kids that are listening throughout this.
Christmas, obviously good. Thanksgiving, I like cooking, but kind of a big ordeal sometimes.
Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah, I kind of like Labor Day. I thought that's or Memorial Day. Start of the summer? Memorial Day.
Memorial Day. Labor is later in the year. Yeah. And that's why I like President's Day too, because it's early in the year.
Yeah.
So you get like a nice, like, these are the ones I know I'm gonna get off. I mean, I love Thanksgiving. I love cooking on Thanksgiving, actually. I really like making the turkeys. And I like the football going on around it because I'm doing DFS while freaking out over a turkey. But I never feel relaxed after that, right? It's not until a couple days later. Plus, there's the stress of the UNC State game right then, too, which has kind of ruined it for the last couple years for me. Thanks, Mac.
Barstool Sports just tweeted out, they are Thomas, Drake Thomas, Aaron McLaughlin, and Chase Graham are now Barstool athletes. Whatever that means.
Chase Graham?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm glad. Well, so wait. Now my boys show up as Barstool members, but they don't bring Lex with them.
Right?
Boy, that's not a good sign for recruiting, guys. Probably not tall enough to be on the Barstool payroll.
Oh.
That's great. What's the most? Okay, so
most overrated holidays. Three... This is an easy one.
Okay, go.
New Year's Eve.
Oh, 100%. Terrible. Not even a holiday.
Most easily.
That's a punishment.
Yeah. Like, again, that one might have been fun back in the day, and I remember plenty of New Year's Eve parties. But now, I can't tell you last time I was awake at midnight on New Year's Eve. Like, nah.
I want to say this. We were watching Cliffhanger for New Year's.
Nice.
And we paused it, you know, at like midnight because we're like, this is so stupid. I cannot keep my eyes open and I want to. This is such a bad movie. And then we came back the next day to finish it on Amazon and it was removed from their catalog. So I hate New Year's. I hate it.
Ruined Cliffhanger for me.
Let's see. What else is like an overrated day? Arbor Day. Never get it off at work. I mean, yeah, July 4th, I don't care for fireworks.
Yeah.
Let's see. What else would I say is, like, just a truly overrated... I don't know. Does anyone really like Easter?
I was going to say, we're going to start offending people here. We start
bringing in religious holidays. I know we're going to offend it, but I'm thinking it from just a pure, like... What?
No, it doesn't do anything for
you know,
me.
It's fun. It's fun seeing the egg hunt and things like that. But it's, I'm not. I don't look forward to that.
Easter's good when you're like 4 to 12, and then like 35 up when you have kids that are 4 to 12, right? Because that's all it's really is buying chocolate for your kids. Although the Cadbury mini eggs are the best holiday candy by far, and it's not even close.
I've never had the mini eggs. I was always a big fan of the big Cadbury egg.
Oh, no. The mini ones are the best.
I assume the minis are just mini versions of that?
No, they're just...
Like bite size? Or
they're basically just chocolate with a little crunchy shell, like big M&Ms, but they're way better.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Huh. Best holiday candy. Not even close. Would you trust a...
Who else can we offend?
Would you trust a self-driving car from Raleigh to L.A. more or Jeff Bezos' space trip?
God, I really want to go into space. would I risk it? What kind of self-driving car is it?
There's probably not that many out there. Like, the Teslas are the only ones, but I think that's only going to be a highway.
Yeah. I feel like I'm more likely to live if Jeff Bezos is connected to the space trip. Oh man, this is a terrible choice.
If Bezos is going with you, you know you're
if I'm dying, I'm dying in space or in an attempt to get in space. Yeah. So I guess I'm going with Bezos.
Yeah, me too. Yeah.
Plus I know that after the trip, he will have copied whatever positive benefits there were from my experience, and then he's going to replicate it as an Amazon version of me for cheaper to take along. So
I'm going to order my will on Amazon.
That's right. That's right. I just heard about this today. I wasn't aware of this. Now, has he sponsored some company to do this, or how?
Who? Bezos?
Yeah.
He owns Blue Origin, the rocket company.
Oh,
so it's SpaceX competitor. And he's going to space and he sold basically the passenger seat to some guy for a lot of money.
Well, he's also taking a woman who was like denied through the NASA program, I think.
Oh, okay.
She's like 80 something now. And I was like, Jesus, she's going to die going up there. And that's good.
Wow.
That's going to be great.
That's wild.
I think her name was Winnie something, but she, for some reason, she had always tried to be an astronaut, and I was listening to NPR today, and that was brought up. But anyways, so I guess I'm going to space, and I'm dying with Jeff.
Sounds like fun. You and the 80-year-old. Yeah. Anyway, interesting. That's a good question.
Now, is he? I guess he's just getting into like low orbit, right?
Yeah. So that's the thing. He's not like going to space. It's like low orbit space. It's basically as low as you can go to be counted in space. Which, I mean, it's still pretty cool. But
will gravity have influence on you still?
That's a good question. I would assume if you're in low orbit, then no.
Okay. Yeah, you would think, right? Because it's got to orbit.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ. Well, I was a physics major at one point.
You're the engineer. I'm the marketing guy.
You know, it's been a long 24 or 48 hours in this household.
That's right.
So,
party time.
It is a party time over here.
All right. Anything else? Any other Mac Brown rants you want to go on?
No, just that he's old and lame. And, I cannot wait for us to beat them this year. God, it's going to be so nice.
Yeah. We better beat them.
We better beat them and go 7-5.
Oh, God. The one cool thing, if people didn't see the Mississippi State kid that hit the home run, held up the Wolfpack sign as he was around the bases, that was pretty badass.
Now, I did notice, or I don't know if it's just the angle of the from the camera, right? But it looked like more like a hook 'em horn.
Yeah, I mean, whatever. I don't expect the Mississippi State guy to get the wolf sign perfectly accurate. The fact that he retweeted it when somebody else said something about NC State he was in. So that was clearly what he was doing. But
yeah, no, I appreciate that. I think we said it earlier, but like, if they don't have something for the Pac-13 all over the Doak Stadium, you know, then that's a miss. I think we were saying something about that earlier, but
yeah,
they better celebrate what those guys did and don't do it in some kind of dismissive way. It should be front and center, and it should be in the, if they can make it so every time there's a ball going into the outfield, it's the first thing the camera sees.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. No, you were slighted.
I'd probably, you know what I would do? I would probably, they should just like burn it into the infield.
Right? Just, yeah, grow some, like, red grass. Yeah.
That would be awesome. I think that's called paint.
Paint, sorry. Paint it in the outfield. Burn it in there. Anyway, you can do it. All right, that's all I got. Thanks, as always, for listening. Thanks for supporting the site. And we've got some good things coming, man. If you want to get in on this new fancy podcast thing we got going, we might be able to have an audience, all sorts of fun stuff. Join the site, support the pod. And that's all I got.
Applause.
Dramatic pause. And now I'm going to run through all of my soundboard things. I had to bring a couple over for you.
G'day, curd nerds. Another cheese making taste test. This one, something special.
Can we pay him?
Oh, I should be able to pay him, right? Can he get?
Because all I got on my mind right now is some ice cream. So.
Did you play that for the podcast with Chance?
I didn't, but I should have. Yeah.
It would have triggered Chance. I don't think it would.
Yeah. All right, folks. We're out. Go Pack.
Go Pack.
I was straight.